Thank you, Misha. And I'd like to begin by saying thank you not only to Susan for inviting me, but to all of the people who work with Susan, who have done a fabulous job, I think, at putting on another wonderful conference. I mean, you know, it's just what one comes to expect at the Einstein Forum. It's really been terrific. And I'm very sorry that Diana Pinto isn't here, because Diana and I had talks that differed by a single letter. She was going to talk about ugly truth, and I'm going to talk about ugly truths. And I suspect that we would have been very much in agreement about things. Anyway, as you can see, I've selected a very ugly PowerPoint, and that's deliberate. And I'm going to begin, as people have before, with Keats. And you wouldn't think that Keats and James Watson had much in common, but they do. So there's the final stanza of Ode on a Grecian Urn, a deliberately sort of rather soppy picture of Keats looking moonily at the Grecian urn. So notice that actually the famous lines are not asserted. They're part of advice that's recommended. And maybe we should make something about that, but many people don't and think that beauty is truth, truth beauty. And so Jim Watson, famously in The Double Helix, the book that he wrote about the discovery with Crick, says, the structure was too pretty not to be true. And one can understand that very easily, because there have been all these puzzles in genetics about the ways in which genes that have lost their function in sort of ordinary organic metabolism and the ordinary phenotype of the organisms can nonetheless retain the function of being copied and handed down the germline. This is known for a time as Muller's paradox. He could X-ray and produce mutants and basically bombard the hell out of organisms and produce these completely dysfunctional creatures. And yet, the genetic material would continue to be reproducible. How was that possible? It fell right out of the double helix. However, the sequence of bases along the strands is modified, the helix will unfold and serve as a template for the copying of a new one. And so in the paper that Watson and Crick announced this result, they famously concluded with a laconic sentence, it has not escaped our notice that this provides a mechanism for the copying of the genetic material. It was indeed too pretty not to be true, in a certain sense, that it looked, and this captures themes that were sounded yesterday afternoon, that it was immensely fecund. That is, you could get an enormous number of apparently diverse consequences out of a single unifying principle. So there are genuinely beautiful truths. Mathematics is often seen as a great source of aesthetic beauty, and this is Euler's beautiful identity. Now, for those of you who hated mathematics, let me just say why this is so beautiful. You take the three most problematic numbers in 18th century mathematics. The base of natural logarithms, e, the ratio of the diameter to the circumference of a circle, pi, and the very dubious square root of minus 1. You perform this incredibly peculiar operation of exponentiation. You know what squaring and cubing is, but you know, and you can even do fractional powers too. But you know, these are very weird numbers to use as an exponent. And what do you get when you raise e to the power I pi? Something not bizarre and crazy, but minus 1, right? So this is indeed a beautiful identity, and it's beautiful in that it connects two fields that seemed utterly separated, the logarithmic functions on the one hand and the trigonometric functions on the other. It's a remarkably unifying bit of mathematics. And even if we just stick to mathematics, there are some beautiful truths, but lots of ugly ones. So think about this one. It's a famous theorem proved in the 1970s with the help of a computer. It's called the the four-color theorem. So if you take a map, or more strictly, a map where you only allow, as it were, two countries to meet at a single point, then any planar map can be colored using four colors such that no two adjacent regions share a common color, which is what you want in maps, of course. You want the colors to show you where the countries stop and a new one begins. The original proof of this theorem not only was done by computer, or is computer-assisted, but it required looking at 1,936 individual cases that had to be handled separately. It's since been reduced to 633. But it's the epitome of mathematical ugliness, sort of slog and bash, right, as we used to call it when I was a lad. And even what is an apparently beautiful truth, the Fermat's last theorem, as Fermat coyly said, I have discovered a remarkable theorem, but the margin is too small to contain a proof of it. And some centuries later, Andrew Wiles announced a proof, which initially was incorrect, had to be fixed up. But it takes up 129 journal pages. That isn't quite slog and bash, but it's still incredibly opaque and complex. So there are lots of ugly truths around, and when you get away from mathematics, they occur with great frequency. So let's turn to the molecular biology of the gene and results from the Human Genome Project. So the disease cystic fibrosis results from a mutation in a particular gene which is found on human chromosome 7. More than 1,700 different mutations are now known. The severity and the likely effects of the disease depend on which mutation has occurred. So here again, we've got this just disorganized, long laundry list of connections between particular kinds of mutated DNA and particular phenotypes. And at this point, I want to insert something which I think was overlooked in the discussion yesterday afternoon and is often overlooked in discussions about truth and beauty in science. And that is that some of the truths that science gives us are not simply stepping stones to further research. They are not rooms into which we enter in order that we may pass through further doors, to use Jan Philipp Rensmann's metaphor. They are rooms that contain materials that we want to use in the here and now. And this is a very important truth. It's not an insignificant truth. Since the discovery of the of this mutation, cystic fibrosis hasn't been cured, but it's been relieved to a considerable extent. The life expectancy has gone up, and it's now possible for the people who suffer from cystic fibrosis to avoid many of the periodic crises to which people with this disease are vulnerable. And looking into the future along the same lines, the genetics of schizophrenia has been incredibly contested. I don't know whether by the time the genetics is worked out, we will still be talking about schizophrenia. It's quite possible that that category may be replaced by another one. But assuming that we are, it's, I think, almost certain that variations at many loci in the human genome will contribute to schizophrenia, and that the more of the variations an individual has, the higher the probability of developing the disease, and that there will be interactions among loci, gene-environment interactions of many kinds, and also epigenetic effects. One of the things that Jens Reich's beautiful presentation yesterday afternoon didn't mention is that that appallingly long list of A, Gs, Cs, and Ts now we know that the such sequences are liable to be read in very different ways. That it's not only that the reading frames, which bits of the sequence get expressed are different, but the ways in which the resulting products will be spliced is different, and it's an immensely complicated tangle of things. So whatever we get, and it will be important for human well-being, in the future about the genetic bases of the disease we now call schizophrenia, it's likely to be appallingly complicated. And I want to say again, however complicated it is, it will be well worth having, if only to help in the early stages of diagnosing, which is at the moment what human genetic and human genomic research has primarily been useful for. Okay, so underlying what I've said is the idea that what makes a truth beautiful is that a beautiful truth discloses an unsuspected order. That, I think, is true both for the Euler identity and to the double helix, that we recognize a unity underlying diversity, an order that we hadn't previously suspected. David, in his poignant talk on the first evening, said, you know, order in itself isn't the whole story, and that seems to me right. It's got to be order that somehow surprises us, that shows us something that we hadn't previously seen. That's where beauty comes. And both the Euler identity and the double helix model seem to me paradigmatic of that. Okay, now, that has inspired many scientists. Thomas Naumann pointed this out yesterday afternoon, and I'm going to add to the cast of characters. Here's Newton commenting on the results of the Principia. I wish we could derive the rest of the phenomena of nature by the same kind of reasoning from mechanical principles, for I am induced by many reasons to suspect that they may all depend upon certain forces by which the particles of bodies, by some causes hitherto unknown, either mutually impelled towards each other and cohere in regular figures, or are repelled and recede from each other, which forces being unknown, philosophers have hitherto attempted the search of nature in vain. But I hope the principles here laid down will afford some light either to that or some truer method of philosophy. That has enormous resonances in the decades after Newton. People go out looking for other forces like the forces of gravitation, which they can feed into Newtonian dynamics and do things like botany and chemistry and electricity and magnetism and so forth. And it doesn't work. There are some marvelous things that come out of this. Boscovich's attempt to do it all with one force with very, very peculiar properties. And that's actually, interestingly, inspires Kant to talk about the reconstructing Newton. There's a lot of interesting stuff that comes out of it, but the dream doesn't get fulfilled. But it lives on in the thinking of physicists to this day. It lives on in the minds of those who dream of a final theory. And it lives on in much of the rhetoric we heard yesterday afternoon about fundamental physics. There is a certain sense in which the physics that Thomas Naumann and Lisa Randall were talking about is fundamental. That is, it talks about space and time and matter and the structure of matter. But it's often viewed, the idea of fundamental physics is often viewed in a much stronger reductionist sense. And I don't know whether they intended this or not. But many people who talk about fundamental physics think that fundamental physics is, in principle, the whole of science. We can eventually get out of physics a kind of unified picture of how the world as a whole works. And that fails, and I think the systematic study of the sciences in the last four decades have really shattered the idea of the unity of the sciences. First, because connections among more and less fundamental sciences are hard to forge. It's not easy to reduce the molecular biology of the gene to biochemistry, because the molecular biology of the gene is shot through with functional notions. Okay, if you think about the ways in which molecular biologists talk about translation and transcription and all the other fundamental processes, they use functional notions which can be structurally instantiated in many, many different ways. But it's also the case that many sciences just don't look like Newton's conception. They aren't easily axiomatizable. We often require not a single set of fundamental laws or principles, but a plurality of idealized models. And that's especially true with another very important area of science, climate science. It seems to me highly unlikely that we will ever get the complete universal model for the climate, that what we need and are better and better sets of overlapping climatic models. So I think the Newtonian dream is false, and I think we should, for that reason, beware of interpreting the message of truth and beauty, which sometimes is developed for certain small parts of physics, as answering either to the whole of physics or to the whole of science. And yet, this is where I twist and turn a little bit. Keats seems to me to have had a point. The drive towards unification and beauty seems to me eminently understandable, because when we can find it, it's really worth having. And it's worth having really for quite pragmatic reasons of the sort that I tried to suggest in response to Lisa yesterday afternoon. Because when we can have it, we can do a lot of practical stuff quite easily. We can deploy the contents of the room into which we've come more effectively, and we can also go on into the further rooms more easily. So I think of the idea of beautiful truth not as a good description of what we find in a messy and complex world, but rather a nice regulative ideal in the Kantian sense. It's something that we should try to achieve, and scientists do sometimes achieve it, because the most remarkable moments where this is achieved are usually moments when the phenomena are completely reconceptualized. One of the things I think that one of the enduring legacies of Kuhn's great structure of scientific revolutions is the thought that reconceptualization is an enormously important tool for scientific advances. So I think that Keats was onto something, and I think that's the grain of truth behind the immense attraction, which is Thomas Naumann's talk in particular showed, many practicing physicists have for the idea of a tight connection between truth and beauty. Okay, so truth is not beautiful. The beautiful is not a good guide to truth, but it's good to seek the kind of unification that scientists and mathematicians have seen as aesthetically pleasing. That's a good idea. It's a good research strategy. But I am increasingly uncomfortable with this, because if we go back to Keats looking moonily at his Grecian urn, it doesn't seem to me that the aesthetic beauty of the scientific picture of the world is quite what's on his mind. It seems to me that what is on his mind is something about human beings. And there is, and Amber, I think, formulated this really beautifully yesterday morning, a thought that the truths, that certain kinds of truths about us expose a genuine beauty, and that there is something in at least some individuals that we can see as, one might say, a human essence, and that it is aesthetically appealing. And I want to turn to that idea, because I think that in the poetry and in the fiction of the 19th century, that idea is quite powerful. I think it's quite powerful in Wordsworth. I'm sure Alida will correct my fumbling attempts to get this straight. But I think this line of thought is quite a powerful one. And it suggests that as we think about ourselves and our own lives and their structures and so forth, we should try to find ways of coming to understand ourselves morally and aesthetically and factually perhaps in a similar way to that that the scientists, with their drive for unification, are trying to achieve. But I also think that, as in the scientific case, this has to be specifically limited, that we cannot, as it were, take over a particular idea of the beautiful or a particular idea of what is unified and try to, as it were, reshape our conceptions of ourselves and what we are doing in that image. And I think that the modernists, whom I love so much, have come to give us a wonderful antidote to an overweening Keats Platonism in the human sphere. And so I'm going to turn, so one thing I meant to say is that the search for beauty and unity is going to be disappointed for rather simple Darwinian reasons. First, because selection is opportunistic, and also our cultural structures are opportunistic. They evolve under a form of selection. So we shouldn't really expect to be able to find a completely unifying, aesthetically pleasing account of really any biological or human cultural domain. So I want to turn back to the main thread of my argument. I want to turn to what I regard as one of the best antidotes to the idea of seeing truth and beauty in close connection to one another. So Ulysses begins with a character Joyce has already introduced to us in A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, who has flown off like Icarus at the end of Portrait and landed like Icarus at the beginning of Ulysses. And after spending some time in his company, some of it pretty uncomfortable, as he walks along the beach, directionless, musing philosophically on the phenomena of perception, we are introduced to the hero, the alleged Homeric hero of the book, Mr. Leopold Bloom, advertising canvasser, who ate with relish the inner organs of beasts and fowls. He liked thick giblet soup, nutty gizzards, a stuffed roast heart, liver slices fried with crust crumbs, fried hen cod's roes. Most of all, he liked grilled mutton kidneys, which gave to his palate a fine tang of faintly scented urine, which actually picks up on something that Stephen says at the very end of the previous chapter, where he envisages his father, sort of alluding to the tempest, his father drowned and transformed into something rich and strange, except the corpse he imagined is offal and urinous. And that is picked up in Mr. Leopold Bloom. Now, Bloom is introduced to us after we experience a character who doesn't perceive the world, but is incredibly good at intellectual theorizing about perception. But Mr. Bloom does perceive the world. He gets the fine tang of faintly scented urine. He sees and feels the light in his kitchen. He listens to his cat and discerns ever more finely what the noises that the cat is making. Now, how is it that we can make sense of a life like Bloom's, or a life like ours, with all its blotches, its indirections, its mistakes, and its downright flaws? That is the brilliance, I think, of Joyce's technique. It is not an attempt to romanticize or to find an essence that is beautiful and meaningful in Bloom. It is rather an attempt to look at Bloom from many, many different angles. First, of course, his own, but later from many perspectives. And so at the end, we come to the end, and we really feel that this is a version of the Homeric wanderer who has survived much in the way of suffering in the course of a long day, tomorrow, of course, And at the end of it, he is still, as the chapter, one of the middle chapters says, the unconquered hero. And it's admirable. It's an exercise in exploring the details, the grubby details, the ugly details of the human, that is intended, I think, at the end to be vindicatory. Not in the sense of a disclosing of something deep and true and beautiful behind the appearances, but understanding the appearances as a whole and vindicating them. That, as I see it, is Joyce's project. And I think of it as a great counter, if you like, to the Keatsian push towards finding beauty and truth together. And if I have time, do I have time? Just for a minute, I want to talk about this in a different mode. And it's a musical mode. I could have gone to the 20th century music that that is so obviously unbeautiful and unconcerned with the beautiful. I could have gone to Varese or Schoenberg or to Ligeti, great composers all, who don't certainly correspond to what one might think of as the ordinary 21st person's conception of what is beautiful. But instead, I'm going to go to Beethoven. Einstein, of course, was fascinated with the beauty of Mozart's music, but I'm going to go to Beethoven, and in particular, the Beethoven who looks forward to the 20th century, the Beethoven whose late work inspired Eliot, and I'm going to the opening of a great string quartet, and let's hope this works. Sacrilege to cut it off. Sorry, but magnificent, horizon opening, penetrating, true, but not beautiful, I think. Or if it's beautiful, it's because we've come to understand its beauty in the way that we might even understand in the end the beauty of Mr. Bloom's relishing of the tang of the kidney, of his responding to Blaise's Boylan by producing the perfect bowel movement, and later by producing a fart echoing Dante, and later by coming home and climbing into the bed and brushing away the crumbs of potted meat that have attended the coupling of his wife with Boylan. We can find, perhaps, in the end, beauty with that, but the beauty has to be won for us, and it seems to me that Joyce and Beethoven show us ways of doing that and understanding the human more adequately and more deeply. Thank you.
Forgive me for saying so, but this was beautiful. Even though as a vegetarian, you know, the Joyce slide was a big plate of ugly for me. Yeah. Susan?
Well, Philip, it was beautiful, and I especially appreciated the beginning of the talk for illuminating things that I really don't understand. But where I think I do understand, I think you're being unfair. Mm-hmm. To take that Joyce quote and then the other ones that you mentioned, and you're the Joyce expert and you've written about Joyce, and I have not, but I do love that book too. You picked out the ugliest pieces in the book, and if that was what the book consisted in, it wouldn't be modernist, it would be postmodernist. It would be in your face, let me see how much grotesqueness I can show you before you put the book away. But as we all know, those are isolated bits of that book. And the very ending, of course, is one of the most beautiful pieces of literature, but there's so many, you know, written in the 20th century or many centuries, but it's the book as a whole. And I just wonder if you could comment on that, because I feel like you just did a postmodernist move, which is not your thing.
No, I know. No, I'm definitely pre-postmodern.
I know, and it's you know, this is not so much by way of argument, but perhaps to get at the difference between modernism and postmodernism, could you comment?
Okay, well, you're completely right in saying that. I selected a small number of parts of the book, but it does seem to me that it's not, of course. I mean, the book has so many registers; it has so many voices in it, and one of its techniques for working through and helping us to see the beauty in Bloom, eventually to see the beauty in Bloom and the nobility in Bloom, is to expand the number of angles from which we see Bloom and see his conduct, and we see them through various lenses and so on and so forth. And some of those are lyrical, some of those are deliberately and profoundly comical. I think of the interludes in the Cyclops chapter. Some of them are wonderful pastiches, as throughout the Oxen of the Sun chapter, and as with the embroidery of Gertie McDowell's speech with the language of sickly sweet, treacly romantic women's magazines. So you've got all of this, but the point is, it's not whether it's. I went for the stuff that aroused. Aroused Virginia Woolf to say that, you know, this is a man with a coarse mind of Joyce. And I guess it seems to me that, in a certain sense, all human life is there, and that's and nothing gets sort of left out or initially downgraded. We're invited to review it again and again and again as a whole. And that's why I think we're never finished with a book like Ulysses. We always go back to it and we try to rework it in the light of an increasing body of experience. Now that seems to me the modernist project, and it seems to me very much, it's like the Beethoven in being, as it were, horizon expanding. And so it's fair to say that, you know, Joyce didn't set out simply to shove various things in our faces and disgust us. But he did want, as part of what he did, to overcome those taboos. And he does that by presenting it all.
My question concerns what seems to me two recurring themes in our discussions of yesterday and today, and your talk seemed to me to pave a way to bring them together, and I'd like you to help me do so. The first is surprise. Mm-hmm. Over and over again yesterday, that motif came up as a kind of insignia of the beautiful and the true. I think of Lisa Randall's remark that even while she is making highly mathematical models, there is a sense of discovery because of the surprise value, and many mathematicians have talked about how
interesting moment in last night's
why the good seems an odd man out in this triumvirate of the true, the good, and the beautiful. And perhaps something has happened to our idea of the good which makes it no longer surprising in some way. Plato, I was trying to get help from Amber to try to remember what the Greek word Plato uses when he calls the good dazzling in The Republic in Book 7, but Jens quoted the Latin, the splendor, which is surely, the Plotinus is surely a Latin translation of that. The good has ceased to be dazzling and therefore surprising. We could speculate about why that is the case. Mm-hmm. I look fearfully at Susan. Could it have something to do with Kant and making the good a matter of duty as opposed to excellence? But I'll stop there. I would be very interested in hearing your thoughts about some possible explanation about why the good has ceased to be dazzling and therefore fertile in wonder in the way that truth and beauty still are, because they pack a surprise.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting, Rainey. I'm not sure I can reply adequately off the cuff to that, but I don't think Kant is to blame for this. But perhaps the idea that is the idea of a morality to which citizens of relatively free societies are bound, and that is, as it were, part of the ordinary world, can be seen as taking away the element of surprise, of dazzle by the morally good. I mean, we are occasionally, it seems, dazzled by... We are occasionally, I think, dazzled by acts that seem to us of extraordinary moral quality. We're moved. We are moved by them. And we do talk about moral beauty. I think that was what I wanted to take away very much from David's poignant presentation on the first evening. But perhaps it's the case that with respect to all of this, it's not just that that people like Joyce and Beethoven open up new horizons for us and expand our conception of the beautiful in new ways, but also that custom dulls and stales, and that perhaps things that would have seemed extremely beautiful and aesthetically pleasing to our ancestors are ho-hum and commonplace to us. And perhaps the various institutions of democratic society might play a role in this, that they might... Well, no, that we've become perhaps accustomed to demanding certain things of ourselves, and so when those demands are met, we think, yes, that's just fine, and we reserve our sense of moral beauty for the truly outstanding acts of the great, of the people we think of as true moral heroes. This connects with some things that Susan's thought about heroism, I think.
Before Sandra takes the floor, let me just tell you that we technically have 6 minutes left and I have 7 people on my list. Please do with that information whatever your moral law commands you to do.
Right. Let me go to the discussion of science, because it strikes me that, and here I will get on my hobby horse again, that the idea that you begin with of Euler and the notion of beautiful is one that deals with 18th century notions, Winckelmann, Schiller, Kant, of simplicity and beauty, right? Stille Größe, right? And that when you then start to look at genetics, you have a kind of desire for that eventually to happen. We want it to happen. And your discussion of schizophrenia is, for me, extremely important. Mm-hmm. Because what you clearly describe is the fact that when we start to look at genetics, we start to look at genetics, first of all, as mechanics, and then mechanics interacting with environment, and then mechanics interacting with environment over time, right? And then the problem of mechanics and the environment and time and in the individual. And you have this kind of a wish that this is eventually going to get resolved as you believe it happened with cystic fibrosis. But then you give yourself a way out. You say, let's look at climate science. Let's look at climate science. What we don't want a model because it's not going to ever happen that connects the all of the climate. We're happy with what? Specific overlapping models. It strikes me that that's the answer to Stille Größe, and that's not beautiful, it's messy. I love messy.
Okay, I love messy too. I hope he wins the World Cup as he deserves.
Iceland.
All right, so the first thing to say is that Euler predates the people you're talking
about.
So it's Euler's sense, and possibly Euler's sense is playing in some way to their formulation of these canons. I don't know that. All right, so the next thing to say is I think that you make a conflation that I worry about when people start to talk about truth and beauty in science. You think about this in terms of a field as a whole rather than thinking about it bit by bit. I think Watson was actually right about the beauty of the double helix model. That seems to me correct. But there are these other bits of genetics which are incredibly important and incredibly particular, and they're a mess. And I don't think we're going to rejoice in the fact that we have them if they lead us to great abilities to relieve human suffering, and we aren't going to worry in the slightest that they're messy and ugly. That seems to me the right attitude to have. But there is this further thing that I think about the expansion of our notion of the beautiful. And I think you and I are at one here. I mean, there is this ongoing project. And it doesn't seem to me that that has developed very far in the sciences. I think the practicing sciences are still back with the old surprise, joining together approach to beauty. But where this really counts, I think, is where Keats started. Keats isn't interested in whether the world can be described by a beautiful theory. He's interested in the beauty of the human, and he's interested in those figures on the vase. And that's why I showed him gazing rather soppily at the vase.
Kostek.
When thinking about this dream of simplicity and the beautiful formula, I was thinking maybe science has a bad case of religion envy. No, religion is supposedly about simple formulas that make sense of the world, right? You shall love your brethren as yourself. This is the greatest thing in the Torah, or Pater Noster, Codes in Celum, or Lo Ilaha Illallah. I mean, these are supposed to be very simple things that solve all. Except they don't. When Hillel tells the Babylonian that all the Torah is contained in the formula, you shall love your brethren as yourself, the rest is commentary. When the Babylonian stands on his 2 feet again, Hillel adds, and now go study the commentary. There is no real promise of simplicity. If anything, in religion, I believe in science as well, simplicity is usually perceived as deceptive and possibly dangerous. There's a great dystopian novel by a Polish writer living in the United Kingdom, Stefan Temerson, called Professor Ma's Lecture. Professor Ma is a termite, lives in a termite colony, fighting an intellectual war against the devious Professor Einfuss Dreistein. It doesn't end well for Einfuss. But the first sentence of that novel is one of the most chilling sentences I've ever read in literature. It goes like this. "Gentlemen," said Professor Ma, and suddenly the world appeared to him as simple and uncomplicated. And you know it's going to end badly.
All right, so look, the religion envy idea is a lovely one. I think, I'll just I defer to Rainey on this, but I'm going to float the conjecture that, of course, it's religious. It has religious echoes because it comes from those thoughts of Copernicus. I want to think the thoughts of God after him. I want to study the mind of the Creator. Science will expose the wisdom and beautiful design of the Creator and the creation. Yeah. So. Amber. Indeed.
Thank you. A couple of comments. One is that I wanted to draw attention to how often, reflexively, without noticing, we associate beauty and understanding. Something's messy when we can't grasp it. Mm. We can't grasp it as a whole in one thought. Yeah. It's beautiful when we can grasp it as a whole in one thought. And that this understanding is closely connected to not to simplicity, which is dangerous, but to unity. Mm-hmm. But so this is where we get the complexity in simplicity. So where we respect all the particulars and all the complexity, but see them as somehow well-related or meaningfully related or something like that. And that this seems to just be what the metaphors and the words we keep reaching for every time we want to refer to something as beautiful or as I think that's or contrast it with the ugly, particularly in the science cases, but not always. I think that's probably part of the Platonic inheritance. But I wanted to make a plea for beauty, which I think that is in keeping with the spirit of your talk. I don't think anybody who thinks that beauty and truth are related seriously thinks that this is even a viable thing worth asserting, thinks that we know already what beauty is. Mm-hmm. It is an openness. To suppose that there's some meaningful connection here is an openness to being astonished by the meaningfulness of something, just as it's an openness to truth and reality. It's a certain kind of orientation rather than some kind of claim about every time I say it's beautiful, I mean it's true. Every time I say it's true, I mean it's beautiful.
Right. Yeah. No, I agree completely with that. But I want to say something about the first. So there are various philosophical accounts of what counts as understanding, what counts as explanation. And for better or for worse, even though I've abandoned it as a complete theory of explanation and understanding, I am the one of the two authors of the it's all about unifying view. It seems to me now that that's inadequate as an account, complete account of understanding. There are forms of understanding that don't fit into that, but it is one form in which we understand, and it may be the one that inspires us to think of truth as beautiful. So, thank you.
So I probably should have asked this question yesterday when all the physicists were here, but maybe Philip can point me in the right direction. So it's about the utility of the regulative idea of beauty. So in the history of science, or maybe even in its current practice, could you say that the belief that there is a simple, unified, beautiful structure behind appearances is more effective as a heuristic of acquiring knowledge, however ugly, however complicated, however messy it ends up being, than starting out at a point that the world is complicated and messy and ugly? That there's something about, it's not so much that we're saying the world is simple, but the belief that it could be is what gets us to its messiness and ugliness.
That was the line I was trying to offer Lisa yesterday afternoon, saying you don't have to believe that the world is simple and unified in order to make use of the methodological principle, seek theories which are simple and unifying. You can simply believe that that's a very good research strategy because such theories are easiest to formulate, to articulate, to test, to modify, and so forth. The truth of the matter, I think, is that even though there seems to be plausible folk psychological evidence that, you know, that might be right, as I said yesterday, it is an empirical issue, and as far as I know, nobody has subjected it to serious test. Maybe, do you know anything about this, Rainey?
I'm just trying to think of what an enormous task it would be.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you'd have to find out. You know, have to interview lots and lots of scientists, and of course you'd only be able to interview the live ones, and that might give you bias sample and so on. So, right. So,
cool. Wait for the mic, please.
Starting with Beethoven and your critique of the 20th century, and moving into the aesthetic and maybe into the natural, let's call it the natural world. How sympathetic are you to historicity as a function of the capacity to judge? Order, beauty, and truth. In other words, it would seem to me we can't hear those phrases of Beethoven without some kind of unconscious sound spectrum that will go from way before to way after.
Yeah. That seems
similarly, the natural body is no longer a natural body because of the history of antibiotics, etc. I mean, there's so many examples. How is that spectrum historically contingent?
Okay, so I'm a card-carrying historicist. That is, I tend to think that with respect to philosophical issues, you don't get anywhere without trying to understand how the various categories that you're thinking about have emerged and what kinds of functions they've previously played. So for example, my own approach to ethical issues, which is very much a this worldly approach to it, I mean, this came out in the interaction with Amber yesterday, is dependent on the thought that we understand our ethical life by understanding how it came to be. And I think that I am not a musicologist, you are. but it seems to me that we hear Beethoven differently than his first hearers of those quartets did. And I'm very much reminded of something that happened to me in Berlin when I was at the American Academy, actually. I went to a concert at the Philharmonie where they played the Schoenberg Third. The Schoenberg Third String Quartet, followed by the Beethoven Third Razumovsky String Quartet. And I thought, this is all wrong. You play the Beethoven first and then you play the Schoenberg. But no. After you come back and you've heard Schoenberg's Third Quartet and you listen to the Beethoven, it's completely different. And you understand why the musicians, according to the story, I don't know whether this is true, ripped up the scores and stamped on them, right? I mean, it comes alive in a way. Now, that's a way of perhaps prodding one back into a more historical form of consciousness. But it can also be done through very serious studies, I think you were suggesting.
Omri.
I have two questions, but they're both brief and they're possibly related to each other. The first is, I thought, but this is a question, I was wondering whether you thought that two different models of beauty emerged in your talk. The one was about unification, almost reduction.
Mm-hmm.
The other, so I'll stop there. I mean, one can say more about that, but the other was of opening the horizon.
Yeah.
Are they the same? Are they different? That's the first question. The second question was about, possibly related, is about, you know, you were talking about what you thought is ugly truth.
Mm-hmm.
But I was wondering whether you actually showed us that ugly things can be beautiful. And or the possibility of that,
okay.
Right? So whether ugliness can open a horizon and in so far be beautiful.
Okay.
And
all
that
right.
With some attunement to existence, we can see the beauty in everything. Because we can see anything opening a horizon. It's easy enough to do this with a Joyce because you can say, look, ugly descriptions, or what's described is ugly, the description is beautiful art. With a Beethoven, this can be done, this is more interesting possibly, because we don't so easily have this distinction between form and content, and we can say something that's not beautiful is beautiful. You ended on that note, Philip, right? You said, it's not beautiful, or if beautiful, then. And I want more about that then.
Okay, so the answer to your first question is I think they're different. And I think that the unification one has been, as it were, dominant. And I think, I don't know, I felt in the latter part of my talk I was articulating a bit by the seat of my pants towards the alternative that I find in Joyce. I don't think I really know how to spell that out in any great detail. But I had thought about talking about the Joli Laid, which I think is genuine, that's a genuine category. And I think you're right. So this is going to have to be really carefully said. So I think it's correct to believe that anything may become beautiful, but I also think it's not the case that everything can be beautiful at once, right? So I think beauty requires a separation of two kinds of things. But it is possible that our eyes may be opened in particular ways to the beauty of something we haven't previously seen as beautiful. And the technique there is the multiplication of perspectives and the cultivation of sympathy, I think. That is, I mean, I think there's something in what David said that resonated with what I'm trying to get at, which is the role of not only, I mean, Amber was talking about understanding, but there's also a role for sympathy here. And that, I think, is something that Joyce and Beethoven in a more abstract way open us up to. So that's preliminary answers to your questions.
Yes. So I really enjoyed the talk. I was trying to think of whether it was a counterexample to your main thesis, in that I found it
very, a philosopher,
Sarah. Very complex and a lot of loose ends, and yet not at all ugly. I've got maybe two questions that I think are closely related. So it's about the end of the talk. So you say that we should try to find the beauty in human lives and also in ourselves, and maybe that's a matter of discovering what's already there or making ourselves more beautiful. But then the stress was on unity. And so part of the question is, I want to hear more about what I would do, what I should be doing if I'm trying to find that beauty in myself, and what the relationship is between that enterprise and trying to become more coherent, mm-hmm. whether that's really the, you know, that's mm-hmm. what it is about when it comes to a human life and a human person. And and one reason to think not is that it's the Joyce example, where it seems as though the everyday that we're coming to appreciate is not something totally coherent. And so then I want to know sort of like, well, what is it I'm discovering when I'm discovering the beauty in the everyday, if it's not unity? And when you responded, you said something like, well, it opens our, our eyes are open to the beauty even, you know, in we can be opened to the beauty of almost anything, including what's ugly. And there I want to understand how to distinguish cases where there's some kind of morally problematic aestheticization mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. of the beautiful. Yeah. I can see, you know, ruin porn or whatever it might be. I can have this aesthetic experience. I can see the beauty in it, and that's a problem, actually, if that's how I'm responding
yeah.
to it.
Yeah. No, you're completely right. I mean, there is, I think, an ethical constraint on this, and that's the simple answer to the last part of what you said. It's completely correct. So I dropped a qualifier in my response to Omri, and the ethical really does put. But now, this is something that I'm thinking about, and I'm in the preliminary stages of thinking about. But the thought is that a multi-perspectival look at ourselves that continues again and again, we're never satisfied with the answer. Every vindication is only a preliminary vindication. The work must be done again. But we try to find a way of seeing ourselves as a whole, but taking account of the bits that don't fit, the uglinesses, the blotches, and we try to work through it, and we keep working through it, and we should. And a part of this is never really being satisfied that we've found a final and definitive way to do it. So, and I think that's in Ulysses. It's also in Finnegan's Wake, which I've and my work on Finnegan's Wake is very much guided by this idea that the book has to go on and on and on around the same sort of complex and themes again and again and again to come to terms with the warts and the ugliness of what's there, and to try to find a way of understanding it and seeing it in a way that will enable a kind of sympathy, but will also respect the deepest sort of ethical commitments that one has. I don't think I can say more about it than that. I mean, I'm interested in Joyce as a philosopher, or as the philosophical aspects of Joyce, and that's where it's pushed me. But it is, as Omri has pointed out, and as you've followed up and pointing out, it's a different mode, and I'm not sure that mode is at all applicable to other contexts. So, I mean, I really wanted to say, you know, the talk sort of winds a bit from starting with a very, what I think is a very simple and very clear conception of beauty, beautiful truth in the case of the physical sciences, through to the thought that the real where this really matters is in human life, and that's what Keats is interested in, and that's why it's for all the, you know, this isn't Keats bashing. This is Keats is involved in a serious enterprise, but I think that the modernists start to teach us to expand that enterprise and to do it differently.
And this, unfortunately, is where we have to wrap up this part of the discussion. Thank you, Philip.